Hello, my friends. Welcome back to coverage of the CFB Pro Showdown. The month is August. The format is historic. I'm Haiyue, and I'm here with Reid Duke. We are about to go into the semi-final round, and we've got a nice, perhaps grindy one coming up here for everybody. It's going to be Inickstrad on Sultai Midrange, who we just saw there take down Rakdos Pyromancer in the quarterfinals. And Nick is going to be playing against Bant Midrange. So let's have a look at the Bant list, since we've seen the Sultai one already. Azure 09 is on Bant ramp, so here's four copies of Uro, Titan of Nature's Wrath, and then a kind of interesting smattering of other cards in this color combination.
Yeah, this is a cool deck. It's sort of like straddling the line between a ramp strategy and a control strategy. Like, we see the Narsets, the Neutralize, the Wrath of God, but also with Explore in addition to Growth Spiral and Uro, like, very definitively trying to get ahead of the opponent on mana, play that quick Teferi, play that quick Elder Gargaroth. Also two copies of Blast Zone, which I think that's really showing respect for the small creature decks, you know, the Rakdos, maybe the Sacrifice decks, Goblins, things like that. But yeah, I mean, sometimes these are some of the more fascinating matchups to watch when it's like some aspects of a mirror match. Both decks have the core of Growth Spiral and Uro, but then we're seeing, you know, who's going to come out on top based on the way they diverge. You know, what's better between Teferi and Nissa? What's better between Sphinx's Revelation and Ugin? And it should be a fun one to watch.
Yeah, I just want to talk about a couple of these one-offs in the deck. Commit to Memory, Elspeth Conquers Death, Sphinx's Revelation, and Tail's End, all just one copy in the main deck there.
Yeah, I like having access to one-offs in a deck like this when, you know, the games are going to go long, you're going to have a lot of mana, you're going to have access to a lot of cards. Having a nice role player card like a Commit Memory or an Elspeth Conquers Death just gives you nice amount of control over the game. Like, you don't want to get really deep in a game and have all these resources at your fingertips and finally realize, like, oh, hey, I actually don't have a way to get that Nissa off the battlefield, or I don't have a way to get that Scarab God permanently gone. But just having like a variety of these role player cards is good. Commit Memory is just a really fun card that I remember from when this existed in Standard. The memory aspect doesn't come up often, but hey, I mean, if you have just tons of mana and some extra time to use that, that can be effective. It makes sure that you're never really going to have to worry about getting decked. So yeah, I like the way that this deck list is constructed.
Yeah, I've definitely seen a few people get got with the old Narset memory shenanigans.
I didn't even think of that.
We'll see whether it comes into play in this matchup. I think we're going to be ready to go down into the action pretty soon. If you're on either side of the matchup here, Reid, what are some of the ways that you're going to try to get ahead?
Well, I'd say my first priority, especially in the early turns, is to get ahead on mana. You know, I really don't want to miss a land drop. I really want to have either Growth Spiral or Uro, because the last thing I want is my opponent to be playing their 5-mana Planeswalkers when I'm not ready, when I don't have my own board position solidified. The next battle to fight after that is going to involve cards like Thoughtseize from Inickstrad's side, and cards like Neutralize. I'm not sure if there was Censor. There's certainly Tail's End and Commit in terms of other counter spells on Azure's side. But basically making your answer cards line up properly against your opponent's key threats.
All right. So looks like it was a seven card keep there from Nick and a mulligan to six from Azure. But does end up with a reasonably nice six here. Narset, Potter of Veils, Shark Typhoon, and that Growth Spiral.
Yeah, I agree. Basically, perfect six, but you know, frankly, a perfect seven from Inickstrad's side. If you give me four lands, Thoughtseize, Growth Spiral, and another card, I mean, I'm playing Sultai if I can have that draw every time.
So Thoughtseize on turn one, I'm going to get rid of that Narset before she can become a problem.
Mm-hmm. And I think Narset is actually quite problematic sometimes in this matchup. Narset's really good against Uro. Like the combination of Narset and, you know, just one or two well-placed removal spells basically invalidates Uro, which, as we know, is one of the key strengths of these strategies. So I think Inickstrad certainly happy to be able to strip away Narset at this early stage.
So Inickstrad going to go for a 2-2 Hydro Crisis, a little a smaller one than we're used to, but still able to get out on the board. As for Azure, the last couple of draw steps have brought some of the more expensive spells there, the Sphinx's Revelation and Elspeth Conqueror's Death.
Yeah, the Elspeth Conqueror's Death, not great on this battlefield, but actually it's going to be ideal against that Scarab God, especially having been drawn after the Thoughtseize. Inickstrad's gonna certainly, you know, shake his head and regret playing into that one.
This single copy of Elspeth Conqueror's Death in the deck coming at precisely the right time for Azure. Just make sure that that Scarab God is no longer going to be a problem for the rest of this game.
Imagine that. Permanently exile the Scarab God. Eventually get back the Narset that was taken with Thoughtseize. This is a huge game changer. That one of Elspeth Conqueror's Death. You highlighted it before the match, and it is coming in big here.
Wow, and Thoughtseize was the draw for Nick. A turn too late to be able to stop this Elspeth Conqueror's Death. Does take that Sphinx's Revelation out of hand for Azure, but still a copy of Shark Typhoon ready to go. And, just removal spells in hand for Nick. Not what he's looking for.
Yeah, since we've been on coverage, we've seen Inickstrad lose one game, and it kind of looked like this one, where basically, they drew too many spell removal spells against threats that could not effectively be answered by the spot removal. And here we see enchantments. We see Shark Typhoon generating, you know, 2-for-1 advantages. We have Castle Vantress waiting. And Inickstrad, our Sultai players, has to say, go. You know, if you're going to play a creature, I can kill it. But if you're going to do anything else, I don't really have a reaction to that.
Yeah, Heartless Act going to take care of the bigger of the sharks here. But Azure still left with that 2-2 shark and this Narset coming back off the Elspeth Conqueror's Death with an extra loyalty counter as well.
Yeah, Eliminate doing nice job here. That's one of the reasons Eliminate is a cut above the other two mana removal spells available, is you can kill something like a Narset. But out of the frying pan into the fire.
Doesn't even matter, Reid. Who needs Narset when Teferi, Hero of Dominaria, is in your deck ready to be found? And this card, you know, the scourge of standard formats past. There's some debate as to whether, you know, he's really still got the power level to be able to compete with cards like Nissa, who shakes the world, but certainly going to do... Gonna do some work here for Azure.
I know where I come down on that debate, and I think I think the Hero of Dominaria still got it. I think, especially being able to untap and pass with a counterspell, or you know, getting additional value with the printing of the castles from Throne of Eldraine, just getting to use these value lands twice in the same turn, or even just cast something and then use the castle as an additional value play. I don't know, Teferi is no joke. If we were all getting sick of losing to the Time Raveler in Standard, but the Hero of Dominaria is really the powerful one. This is the one that you cannot let stick on the battlefield.
Yeah, that Blast Zone, I believe at 2, ready to protect this Teferi. Castle Vantress going to scry and... presumably the intention here to untap that with the Teferi's ability in the end step.
Yeah, great play. I mean, look, a handful of just way too many lands And yet, with the Hero of Dominaria and Castle Vantress.
Sorry to interrupt you there, Reid, but Nissa, a huge rip off the top for Inickstrad.
Yeah.
this team coming in now, Tveri is at four. Will survive this attack, and let's settle this Nissa Tveri debate once and for all right here, right now.
And yeah, the theme of this game also is the answer is coming one turn late off the top of the deck. A second ago was Inickstrad, you know, drawing the Thoughtseize the turn after Elspeth Conqueror's Death. Now it's Azure drawing Neutralize the turn after Nissa. But ooh, man, look at the Shark Token just trying to close out the game against the opponent at seven life.
Wow. And a second Shark Typhoon in hand as well. Also a Castle Unveil on the battlefield for Azure. So it's actually able to present, you know, a lot of threats here for Azure. And is this going to be lethal?
Yeah, it looks like pretty sharp play from Azure there. I think at face value, we might have thought, okay, you know, make a shark to eat one of the attacking lands. But actually, making the shark at the end of the turn plays around Extinction Event, even allows you to hold up Neutralize for the definitive game win, and Yeah, just chips away those last 5 points of life.
My heart was beating in that one, Reid. I thought that that Nissa off the top would have saved the day there for Nick, but Shark Typhoon able to come in for Xaxxes, taking down this game number one for Azure in our semifinals here at the CFB Pro Showdown.
That one was certainly a roller coaster. Had some good back and forth there.
All right, let's have a look at the player sideboards now. Azure on Bant, able to see quite a few different effects in the sideboard. We see Aether Gust coming in, but what else are you thinking about in here?
Well, this is, I think, going to be a lot of trimming. We talked about having those one-ofs, which just from deck construction standpoint, you know, you put some one-ofs in for the course of a long game to have more versatility. But I think that's going to apply to sideboarding, too. Things like one Wrath of God, not a great card in the matchup, but hey, if you get behind a Nissa, it can be useful. And yeah, just a lot of trimming, a lot of one-ofs, three-ofs, things like that.
Yeah, we see one Wrath of God, one Elder Gargaroth, and that one copy of Elspeth Conqueror's Death staying in there for Azure. Nick going to take a little bit more time to think about his sideboard.
By the way, I feel like we got a little bit of insight into Azure's personality there. The title of their deck was Imported Deck Number 16 or something like that. Like, just all business, you know.
There are two kinds of Magic players, Reid. The kind that's imported deck 16. I've seen people with imported deck brackets 655.
Yeah, there's those of us that we got to have all the proper arts for our cards. You know, pick our sleeves, name our deck, all this kind of things. And then there's the people that just could not care less about any of that stuff. Imported deck number 16. That's fine.
I'm sure each side thinks of the other side as somewhat degenerate in this debate. And true to what you say, Reid, no sleeves as well for Azure. The bare deck back there. Dobin's Veto, Narset, Teferi, and Uro. What more could you want in your opening hand? As Thoughtseize is going to take a look here at Azure's hand, that Dobin's Veto immediately going away. Still a second Thoughtseize in hand as well for Nick. And wow, these discard effects doing a number here on Azure's curve.
Yeah, you got to think Thoughtseize one of the stronger cards in the matchup. But having that double Thoughtseize draw, you know, how powerful that is depends on if you can follow it up with something really strong. And in this case, it looks like Nick, maybe if you can get to that Nissa on time, can have something real powerful. But even despite the double Thoughtseize, it kind of looks like Azure is the one who is maybe developing a bit better.
Yeah, as you're able to get the Uro train rolling, Teferi in hand and a bunch of reactive spells, but no fifth land, so unable to go for that Teferi. Back over to Nick, and Nick also decides to just play a tap land, reserving these powerful 5-mana planeswalkers in hand for a later turn. And there's that singleton copy of Tales End.
All right, so I think we're going to settle into a staring contest here where both players are going to probably try not to tap out on their main phase, pick their spots, pass with counterspell mana. And in a game like this, two of the important cards to watch out for are the one we see being cycled for Azure here, the Shark Typhoon, and the one we see in Inickstrad's hand, Hydroid Krasis, because these cards have elements of being uncounterable, cannot be answered directly by a single neutralizer negate.
Oh, here comes Nessa, and that's going to be met with an Aether Gust, as your does have the double counter, the neutralize in hand as well, but Nick going to let that Aether Gust go. I'm just loving these one-offs. It's just kind of insane to see Tails End in a historic deck and actually put in a lot of work here for Azure. Wow, this negate from Nick, but Azure has that neutralized, the second counter in hand. Nick tapped out, and that Nissa is out of here.
Yeah, I agree with the way Nick played it. It's like, let's play my Nissa and force my opponent to have something. You don't want to just sit around and take two from the shark indefinitely. But, you know, that is going to work out really badly. It's totally ideal from the perspective of the Bant player to win the counterspell battle and untap with the opponent, in a shields down position. And here we see the power of the Hero of Dominaria is you get to play it and pass with your commit memory open, you know, and have your Shark Typhoon. So just Azure, our Bant player, totally in the driver's seat here.
Yeah, embarrassment of riches here for Azure. Here comes the Hydro Crisis. X equals 4 for Nick, so a little smaller than we're necessarily used to seeing, but is a 4-4 flyer on the battlefield, and an untapped land means that the negate is left up as well. But Nick's life total, you know, down to 8 and looking pretty precarious against this 2-2.
Decisive -3 on the Teferi. To me, that was not obvious how to play that turn properly. But we've seen Azure be just very crisp, confident, quick player. And I think they have their game plan. They know the way they want this game to end, and it involves these Shark Typhoons and that Hydroid Krasis not being on the battlefield, perhaps the game maybe even ending before the Krasis can come back.
Wow, Azure making a shark in end step, but a little mishap there, making a 5-5 shark instead of the 6-6 that would have been lethal. A GG, though, from Nick, perhaps recognizing the direness of the situation. So that 5-5 shark's actually going to take down Narset, since it wouldn't have been lethal anyway. Nick just with a negate, and Nissa who shakes the world in hand. Difficult to know whether he's kept in any mass removal against this deck. Nissa, the draw, and the play. And that commit is going to try and put it away, but negate off the top. What can Nick even find? Like, Nissa can untap a land. There's a gross pass for a redraw, but
yeah, I guess it's got to be a card that costs 2 mana off of the Growth Spiral. So you need either to find Eliminate or Heartless Act off the top of your library, or you need, you know, for some reason, your opponent to make the choice to attack your Nissa instead of you.
All right. So first things first for Azure, Narset going to hit the battlefield. Has a look through the library. Nick, thinking about whether this is the spot to go for that Growth Spiral and try to find an answer to the larger of the sharks here. And as we know, if he can't find an answer, that is going to do it. But wow, Narset's trigger is actually going to resolve, and Narset finds that Dovin's Veto. And surely this is a lights out now for Inickstrad. Let's see what this Growth Spiral finds. It's a Hydro Crisis. That's not going to do it. And Azure takes this one down 2-0 in a pretty convincing fashion.
Yeah, that was, I think convincing is a good word for it. Just very good showing from the Bant deck, because Inickstrad's draws, they were fine. You know, he did what Sultai does. He had Thoughtseize. He had some mana ramping. But the Bant deck was just able to line up its threats and answers a tiny bit better. That first game, Elspeth Conquers Death, was a huge card that, of course, Sultai, the color combination, doesn't have access to. Mm-hmm. And then the second game was a little bit more of a slog, but, you know, just leveraging those counter spells and Shark Typhoons and Teferi to a victory. Looked good.
Yeah, great stuff there from the Bant deck. We will be seeing Azure 09 in our finals, which we are going to go to after a short break, but very well played, of course, to Nick and all of us, our other competitors, who have not managed to make it to this stage, but we will definitely be seeing more of them. And of course, if you would like to join in on the action, if you want to join in the fun, get your deck list out, start battling and seeing whether you could go up against the CFB pros, just make sure you have a CFB Pro subscription, and tournaments like this are completely free to everybody who's subscribed. All right, we're going to go to a break. After the break, we're going to bring you the grand finals of this event, but that's not going to be the last match, because as we know, whoever wins will have an opportunity to double their money by going against a CFB Pro, William Huey Jensen, so don't go away.